So I'm here in Jerusalem, beautiful view at the hotel I'm staying at, and I'm meeting with a bunch of SEOs this morning. First up, I'll be meeting with Ari Namani from Kahina. We're gonna be talking about a lot of cool things, including hyperlocal SEO, some e-commerce stuff related to SEO and so forth. So I'm looking forward to meeting with him and a bunch of other SEOs.
SEMrush is an online visibility, management, and content marketing SaaS platform. Today, it unites over 5 million marketers worldwide and assists them in their everyday with help of its key tools, competitive research, SEO, content marketing, social media, and advertising. SEMrush always aims to provide a product solution to all marketing experts to ease their workflow. Check out their newly launched tool, Content Marketplace. Now you can order and optimize blog posts in just a few clicks to fuel your content marketing efforts. Check them out at SEMrush.com, and thank you for sponsoring SEMrush.
Ari, thank you for coming out here.
My pleasure.
We're not allowed to mention the hotel name. I went to security and they said no mentioning the hotel name. So we're in a hotel, but we can't mention where it is.
Look around, you may recognize it.
You might, maybe not. Anyway, Ari, can you tell people who you are?
Yeah, so I'm Ari Nahmani, I'm the CEO and founder of Kahina. That's a search marketing agency. And we're based here in Israel, Jerusalem.
Cool. Awesome, thanks for coming out, I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I know you actually drove from like Tel Aviv or some of that area.
Well, yeah, that's where I'm based. Yeah. But my company's around the corner, so it worked out really well.
Awesome, I was in your same office as I
yeah,
was.
Yeah, yeah,
cool.
Yeah.
How big is the company now?
We're 19 people.
19 people. Yeah. Big payroll you got there.
Yes, a lot of overhead.
Awesome. Cool. All right, so let's talk about your history a little bit. So you started in the space in 2006.
Yeah, 13 years ago, started in search marketing.
Okay, cool. And then you started, then you moved into a very spammy world of gaming.
Yeah. I cut my teeth in SEO and sort of, I would say, gray hat stuff in terms of online gambling and gaming. I was an expert in bingo.
Actually. Bingo.
Bingo.
So all you do is play games all day.
No. But we certainly helped other people play games.
Yes.
I learned a ton in an agency world in the very hyper-competitive spaces. And then after a few years, moved out on my own.
And that was pre-Panda and Penguins. So it was probably a lot of fun.
When we started at Kahina, the kinds of things that we did compared to now, just in terms of competition, in terms of link building, it's a different world.
Yeah.
Like, we are completely different since those updates.
So you matured a little bit.
A little bit. No, and a lot.
So what made you start your own agency? You started in 2011.
I don't think I went out to start an agency. I think I wanted to kind of branch out to different areas of SEO. And I went out as an independent consultant, and some friends in the US started giving me more work, sort of white labeled work. And I was just exposed to a whole other world beyond that very hyper competitive niche. And sort of by accident, the agency happened. I hired a few friends in the industry here in Israel. And so Kahina is all native English speaking expats, right? So it just grew very fast. And we are where we are today.
It was funny, I was like, doing intros for these videos and mentioning all the names of the people I'm interviewing, as well as the company names.
Right.
And my wife's like, you're not pronouncing these as an Israeli would. I'm like, I don't
yeah.
know.
I'm well, pretty it's actually,
how long is it going to take you to learn like how to speak like an Israeli?
I mean, I think, I didn't like really speak Hebrew through college and after visiting here a few times, but it wasn't until I was negotiating contracts and stuff that I feel like I picked up on it pretty well.
That must be hard negotiating contracts.
I mean, it's hard. I mean, Google Translate helps.
It does, okay.
To cool. a point.
All right, let's get into the SEO topics. So I know you want to talk about, first thing is like hyper-local SEO stuff.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this is really interesting because what used to be called, I guess, like Google Places, now Google My Business. I mean, it's changed
Google Plus
dramatically.
Local.
Yeah, right, yeah, Google Plus Local.
It has lots of names.
Yeah, there, and a
but
lot
now
of
it's
iterations.
Google My Business.
Right, it's Google My
For
Business.
For now.
And I mean, like, luckily through the years, we've been able to attract larger and larger clients, and most recently have these sort of like multinational, or at least, you know, at scale brick and mortar businesses.
Right.
So, I mean, like, some of the stuff we've learned applies to mom and pop local businesses, but it's been fascinating sort of trying to rank at a hyper-local level and track at a hyper-local level to see when people are on their phone and they're searching for, like, you know, restaurants near me or whatever their service is, to see how Google is showing both a map pack and traditional blue links at, like, a very hyper-local level. So we're trying to react to that.
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting because I know like Google's downplayed the personalization stuff they've been doing recently.
Right.
But like when it comes to personalization, the real thing we do is local.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've been able to identify that even the like crappiest of website, as long as it's associated with a Google My Business listing or an entity whose address is near, so from a proximity perspective, they can rank. Like with barely any text on the page against like very serious competitors. So trying to figure out how to, you know, combine proximity and sort of the authority with citations and ratings with traditional SEO.
Right.
That's been really interesting for us, and we've seen a lot of success for both mom and pop and large scale.
Have you seen any changes? Remember, like Google just neural matching stuff. They came out first time and really kind of confirming a Google local update.
Do you know what's interesting is like I don't know if it's there's less people who are reporting to you or to others like you at scale around like large. Where they actually see a massive impact. Because if you're just one business, you may just see a blip,
right?
But if you're seeing this with 1,000 plus locations, you'll see major. There was something not too long ago that wasn't reported anywhere, and we just saw massive changes in the way that Google My Business.
Early November?
It was August. I'll send you something afterwards. But also in November, we did see a slight difference, but not nearly as much as we did. So I wonder if there's just like less reporting on the local space.
No, I mean, there is less reporting because it's a much smaller niche.
You have
SEO is a niche, and then you have within SEO different niches.
Of course.
And there's a massive local SEO community. And I track that community. And then now that we have finally, I think Bright Local, Bright Edge, one of these companies has a tracking tool, kind of like the Mozcast type of tracking tool, Rank Ranger's tracking tool.
But I do think that there's a lot fewer people working at scale, or at least talk about it because they're working for enterprise businesses.
Right.
And so they're just not as forthcoming. So I wonder about that. But there has been a lot of fluctuation, even just in the fact that like the website button, like Google's really not trying to send people to websites anymore. At least that's their behavior. So as opposed to that big website button in the map pack, now you have to kind of like dig through to find it. And we've seen that. Over the last 2-3 years, like the click-throughs to the websites have dramatically reduced, so we've had to react to that. We've had to try to figure out.
It doesn't matter. I mean, because most of these people searching for local businesses with local intent,
right,
are just trying to get directions.
Well, so that's exactly right. We've had to build like revenue models of saying like this many people click get directions year on year. The average may be like, let's say 80, 90% actually visit the business when they click get directions. What's the conversion rate? So we've kind of merged with in-store stuff.
Right.
And tried to build a model because we have to sell ourselves or services,
right.
We have to explain that, oh yeah, we're up year on year. The traffic to the website may be down, but like you have to consider the offline revenue.
Right.
It's kind of hard sell, but if you build a model, it's interesting.
That's how local SEO sells their stuff. I even know a lot of the really, I guess, high-end shops, they're doing like a lot of beacon stuff where there's tracking to see if the person did the click or did the search, and do they eventually end up in the store and are they purchasing
this on that? Right. Yeah, there's a lot of models that you can build.
Cool. All right, let's move on. Anything else you want to say on hyperlocal stuff?
One thing I think is really interesting that not enough people do is building hyperlocalized pages on your website itself. So if you've got multiple branches or even one, is having a location page that's optimized, or even sub pages under that location pages for keywords that are localized. So your title tag, your page copy is all optimized with the address. I mean, anything you can get in a local database, even like the manager's name, anything that makes it more unique, that will help you rank. And we've seen that when you connect it to the Google My Business.
Back in the day, we used to like, early
Rusty
days,
Brick or
anybody, whatever. It was like the SEO community. You literally just take their services. So let's say, I don't know, SEO services.
Yeah.
And then break it down by each little
micro locale.
Yeah,
right?
So it might be like, I don't know, Manhattan. It might be like Suffern. It might be a new city. It might be.
Yeah. You can do zip codes.
Make these huge glammy pages with basically weather information and like you know, anything you can find on Wikipedia.
Right.
So
I mean, but building
that
out those
doesn't work anymore.
Well, the HTML sitemap stuff we find really works. Yext does this out of the box. You know, like Yext can build a subdomain. So like by city, by micros,
Cool. Well, I don't know if that's definitely recommend. I mean, that level, you have to provide unique value on every.
Correct. And if you have like, you know, 1,000 locations, you're going to need to buy a location page for every one.
Right.
So, you have to do it in balance.
Yeah, you have to actually have a physical presence.
Oh, absolutely. Value. You shouldn't be. This is like, you need a physical location.
We're not talking about your early days in the gaming.
Just get like a phone number and
awesome.
Virtual.
Let's talk about e-commerce stuff. I know we don't talk about much about e-commerce stuff on this vlog, but what do you have to share about e-commerce?
I mean, I just think it's been a real challenge, especially for retail brands. Well, first of all, if you're not a retail brand, I mean, we're just seeing people getting killed over the last few years. If you don't sell something that's super unique or provide a unique experience, if Amazon sells your stuff, you're just getting killed. Even for those that are real brands that have like real stores and have brand presence, even like year on year, Black Friday, we just had Cyber Week, and we're seeing flat traffic for all search, paid and organic. And you drill down, organic's getting hurt, and people have to pay a lot more just to have the same amount of clicks, right? So more impressions on organic, way less clicks.
Why
because of a changing SERP. A changing SERP plus just increased competition on the paid side.
I mean, okay. So it's not necessarily like people are just going straight to Amazon.
Not necessarily. Right. It's just that the SERP is different. So if I type, I don't know, refrigerators, right? You're going to see like a
shopping,
and then you'll have that new sort of like organic PLA thing, if you've seen that. It's like, it's sort of like a description and of each of a few sample products. And then you'll have like people also search for, and you'll have like, did you mean stainless steel? Did you mean French door with those little images? So like, it's a, and then four ads. Right. So, and on mobile, it's just, so it's nearly impossible. So we could be ranking number two year on year, same position, and massively decreased CTR.
That makes sense.
And then paid has to make up for it. So what we've done is try to, I mean, Will Reynolds talks about this a lot, but it's just trying to coordinate with paid data a lot more to see like, where are you guys bidding on? Where do you not have to? How do we save money? But you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars more a month in paid search to get the same amount of net clicks. And then you have more people on mobile devices. And so the conversion rate's way lower. And so basically what I've seen, and we've, you know, we've had to, we've lost clients because they've either closed or whatever. The e-commerce world in terms of retail is really hurting from an organic perspective for sure. It's kind of why we've diversified and we have a paid search team now and trying to sort of offer that in a combined way. But it's really going to be interesting about what do you have to offer as a, as an e-commerce brand that it goes above and beyond just organic ranking. How do you get your conversion rate better? How do you get returning visitors? Right. How do you build a brand? I think that it's impossible to kind of create a new e-commerce brand these days from scratch.
Right. I mean, you're competing with Amazon, and once Amazon figures out your source,
I don't know, 5-10 years ago, I feel like you could start a new brand that e-commerce was a player.
Right.
Unless you have brick and mortar as like a, as an experiential component,
right.
I don't, it would be challenging. We don't take on a lot of startups as a, because we just like, we can't.
It's also dangerous thing.
Yeah,
right. Bills.
Yeah.
In any event, thanks so much for doing this. This is a great time. Could you tell people how they can follow you, learn more about you?
Sure. Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, just Ari Nachmani, and our website, kahina.com.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Great chat to you.